What's up, everyone? It's Cole Davis. Got a special video for you today. We're going to be breaking down the melodic genius of Scott LaFaro. And I'm going to be doing so on his bass. His original bass, where he played all those great solos, those great bass lines. I have this bass in my possession right now. I am not freaking out. Shout out to Madeline Crouch of the International Society of Bassists and Manny at Kolstein's Bass Shop for blessing me with this instrument. It's only mine for the week, then I have to give it back, and hopefully some other great bass players will get to try it. We're going to start with my favorite example of his playing, which is Solar from Bill Evans' trio, Live at the Village Vanguard. Okay, so that was really bad. That was really, really bad. For my non-jazz listeners, bad means good. You say something is bad when it's actually good, and bad. Anyway, yeah, that was awesome. I'm gonna show you why that was so special and so unique and so ahead of its time. First of all, Scott LaFaro invented broken time. He was the inventor of broken time. And broken time refers to a way of playing where you acknowledge that the quarter note is supreme, but you play around the quarter note. So you acknowledge that the time exists. There's a pulse, there's a quarter note pulse. It comes from quarter notes in 4/4 time, but you don't have to play quarter notes all of the time. You can break it up. And the way he played broken time was so innovative that we still play that way today. So let's break down exactly what he did that makes this so special. So this first chorus, he's really playing the harmony. There's this myth that in order to play broken time well, you have to play out, and you have to play all this sort of inconceivable stuff that sounds like it came from nowhere and it's reinventing the wheel and whatever, but he's sticking to the harmony here. He's really making a point to play the roots except for this one bar. In that bar, he kind of goes off a little bit, but it's part of the line. It's part of the line that he's playing, and he comes right back to the changes. So this is an example of functional accompanying while still being really creative and really interesting. He did both at the same time. Now we're going to look at the second chorus. Check out what he does here. So here he's literally playing the melody, but he's not playing the melody in a way that announces that the bass is playing the melody. You know what I mean? He's not playing the melody like, hey everyone, the bass is playing the melody. He's playing the melody as a part of the song. You know, I've been on a lot of gigs where I'm asked to play the melody on a tune, and there's a certain protocol that follows, which is everyone in the band drops in volume. This doesn't happen all the time, but a majority of the time this is what happens. The band drops in volume, everyone in the audience puts down their food or their drink or whatever, and they're all like, you know, shh, shh, the bass is playing the melody, everyone shh. But it doesn't have to be like that. You know, the bass can play the melody as a part of the song, and that's exactly what Scott is doing here. He's playing the melody while Bill Evans, the pianist, is soloing. Really interesting. Thank you. Okay, so in that third chorus, he plays the melody again. He's playing the melody underneath Bill's solo. Now, this is insane for a bass player of that time. 1961, no one would ever think that a bass player was allowed to do that. And interestingly enough, on the cover of this record, it says, Bill Evans, Live at the Village Vanguard, featuring Scott LaFaro, which was definitely very unique for a bass player. There aren't too many records, especially not of that time, where a bass player was featured, so much so that his name appeared on the record, sort of like a featured actor in a film. You know, that's interesting to me. But what he does in this third chorus is he develops the melody. So the same way a horn player would play the melody to a tune in the first chorus and then sort of expound on that melody in the second chorus, that's what he's doing, but he's doing it underneath a piano solo. Really amazing. Then in the fourth chorus, he goes nuts. Okay, so that goes back to the combination of functional accompaniment and solo. And you're probably thinking, that's the least functional thing I've ever heard. If I did that, if I was a bass player who did that on a gig, I would just get fired and that would be it for me. But that's not the case. What he's playing is very much within the harmony. And instead of playing a functional accompaniment in the lower register and playing quarter notes, he's playing counterpoint. Counterpoint, most of you probably know this, but counterpoint is when two voices move against each other. And when we walk a bass line, we're actually playing counterpoint. We're not just, you know, prisoners to the quarter note. We're actually engaged in a counterpoint with both the drummer and the soloist, the rhythmic counterpoint of a quarter note against the ride cymbal and the melodic counterpoint of a bass line against a solo. So Scott is doing exactly this. He's just not playing 4-4 time the way we're used to hearing 4-4 time. Check out what he does here. He's very clearly outlining the harmony in these few bars. And it's interesting because Paul Motion, the drummer, is actually just playing straight time. He's coming from bebop drumming, so he's playing very strict time, which is hard to hear because of all the activity, but he right now is the glue tying it all together. It's really cool. The other thing is, Bill Evans is actually not responding in the way that we often assume. This band is often referred to as the first interactive trio, whatever that means, but it's not really interactive as much as it is everyone's just playing different parts. We call it interactive because they're not playing 4-4 time the way we're used to hearing a straight-ahead trio play 4-4 time. But it's no less interactive than the trios that came before them. They're just playing 4-4 time in a different way, and they're just playing two sequences of ideas at the same time. They're actually not really interacting in the way that we do today, in the sort of like cat and mouse, you know, one person plays an idea and then that other person echoes it. They're not interacting in that way. They're both playing separate parts, but they're aware of each other, and that's the essence of counterpoint. So the idea that this was interactive playing, actually not really. They're interacting with each other because they're listening, but they're playing very different parts that work together in a really interesting way. Last thing about this, then we'll move on. That C, that strong beat one, it's gotta be one of the strongest beat ones I've ever heard in my entire life. He's playing so much tension before that. So much activity, so many things that you wouldn't expect from a bass player. And then when he hits that C, it's powerful. It's beautiful. I have goosebumps thinking about it. Now we're gonna move on to something that is an actual solo, as opposed to a soloistic bass line. We're going to talk about how he approached soloing and how he was unique in that regard as well. Thank you. that's his solo on Nardis, which is also a recording from the Bill Evans Trio. This recording is called Explorations, and the song is called Nardis. There's always a dispute about who actually wrote this song, Bill Evans or Miles Davis. We weren't there, you know. I don't want to make assumptions, but it does sound like a Bill Evans tune, let's be honest. He's also doing certain things that bass players at that time didn't do intentionally. He's coming at it purely from a harmonic standpoint, as opposed to a standpoint of language. And language generally refers to taking Charlie Parker's language and applying it to different instruments. That's basically what playing bebop refers to. And today we just call it language. When you hear the term language, that's what we're talking about. But he has very little language in this solo. I'm sure he could have played language if that were asked of him, but he's not thinking about it in terms of language. He's thinking about it in terms of harmony. So he's just addressing certain chord tones as opposed to playing language that has certain chord tones. I think that's really interesting. So instead of playing bebop lines, he's just playing certain harmonic colors. That was very rare for bass players at that time. Most bass players at that time were coming out of Paul Chambers, and they played bebop, and they played solos a certain way, and they played bass lines a certain way. But he thought about the chords differently. Let's look at what he did with the chords that made him so special. So that's bar 9 and 10 of this solo. So he's playing an extension on both of those downbeats. On those beat ones, he's playing an extension. And that goes perfectly with the chords that Bill Evans is playing. I don't actually know what voicings he's playing because I don't play piano. But I do know that they complemented each other perfectly. And the voicings go with these extensions and different notes that Scott was playing. It was very uncommon at that time, especially for a bass player, to just lay on an extension on beat one of a bar. You either played the root or you played some kind of language coming out of bebop, but Scott did none of that. It's very interesting. So that's what he played going into bar 15, and that's also using some extended harmony. Again, bass players at this time were aware of extended harmony because there's tons of extended harmony in bebop. But they weren't using it in this very deliberate way that just addressed the changes, as opposed to playing lines over the changes. The other thing he does in this solo that's so brilliant, and he does this in a lot of his other solos, is he phrases over the bar line. So as a bass player, I'm very used to beat ones. Beat ones are the most important element of playing jazz bass. So it's very difficult for us to think over the bar line, which means that you play a phrase that maybe doesn't land on beat one, or you play a phrase that maybe doesn't start on beat one. You're playing through the bar lines as opposed to playing each individual bar. And as a bass player, you kind of have to play each individual bar when you're playing time. But what was interesting is that he freed himself from that when he was playing a solo. So he plays these phrases that go above and beyond bar lines and kind of take you into a different dimension, takes you into a different space. Let's check it out. And the other thing he does is he uses the upper register, which now a lot of us use the upper register. Now it's very common and it's cool to use the upper register and imitate the voice or a horn player, but when he used the upper register, no one else was really doing that. He was one of the first to break through and use the upper register in his solos. So that was very uncommon. I challenge anyone to find a upright bass solo from that time that uses those notes in that way, that uses that register. Also, his intonation up there is great. I mean, I struggle to play in tune up there sometimes, but he always seemed to be in tune, which is an overlooked aspect of his playing because everything else was so creative. But we often forget he was a great technician as well. He played almost everything with very good intonation. That line is just beautiful. I have nothing to say about that. That is a very, very elegant, beautiful, melodic line. I'm not even going to analyze it. All right, so as remarkable as he was in both soloing and Broken Time, he was equally remarkable in terms of his walking lines. And that's something that he doesn't get a lot of credit for, but he was equally influential in his walking bass lines. We're going to check out a walking bass line that isn't from the Bill Evans Trio, but is actually from a Hampton Hawes record. This bass line is on a Cole Porter tune called I Love You. So what's amazing about this bass line? Well, the first thing is movement. Each two-bar phrase has movement. It either moves up or moves down. What do I mean by that? Well, if you actually draw lines through this bass line, you can see how it moves. And to me, that's the most important element of a great bass line. Even more so than the notes themselves or what the notes do to the chord is that the bass line has movement. Because that's what makes it feel good. Of course, you gotta play the changes. I'm not advocating for not playing the changes. But if your bass line has movement, you can get away with a lot of things. And that's exactly what he did. He got away with a lot of different things when he was walking bass lines. So that's interesting. He's using octave jumps, which is quite literally when you play a note, typically in the lower register, and then the next note is an octave up, directly up from that note. And he's doing that to create movement. You kind of create instant movement when you jump up the octave. It's kind of like that low note is a springboard to take you through the next chord. It's really interesting. Also, if you ever get bored playing a bass line, which you shouldn't do, but us bass players, depending on the gig you're on, you can get bored pretty easily. So if you're ever bored, playing those octave jumps is a great way to keep yourself entertained, if we're being honest. If you're bored with just sticking to half position or whatever, do an octave jump, you know, jump around the instrument, have some fun with it. And that's what he did. He always sounded like he was having fun. You know, he always sounded like he was keeping everyone else around him inspired, but also in a way inspiring himself with what he was playing. And I think that's really cool. All right, one last thing, we're going to look at what he played on the bridge here. So this sounds like some kind of classical etude. This is very Bach-like, you know. I love it when bass players play like that. I think it's really beautiful and really interesting. It's sometimes a challenge to keep the swing when you're playing like that. Sometimes when you start playing these elegant, beautiful lines, the swing tends to suffer. But he's still swinging. He can play those lines and still swing, which I think is amazing. Let's listen to the line again. Yeah, that's really beautiful. Much like that line in Nardis, I don't have much to say about that. It's not even necessary to analyze it, because if you're listening, you can hear how much beauty is contained in those four bars. All right, that's it. Thank you for watching this video, and thank you for appreciating the genius of Scott LaFaro's bass playing. It was a real honor to hold this instrument for a week, and now I have to give it back to Kolstein's, which, if you're not familiar with Kolstein's, it's a beautiful bass shop on 58th Street, the Upper West Side of Manhattan. Once again, thanks to Madeline Crouch at the International Society of Bassists, and thanks to Manny at Kolstein's Bass Shop for giving me the instrument and letting me do this video. For more content like this, subscribe to my YouTube channel or follow me on Instagram at Cole Davis Music. CDL.